Hello, and welcome back to the two-button game tutorial. This is part three. In parts one and two, we've set out a layout and set up a great clock component so that the time will count down from 10. This gives you limited time to press the two buttons. In this section, we'll be setting up the multiplayer component of the two-button game. This will let you play on two devices with your opponent. So, for example, if you have one device and you've chosen to play player one, and you're tapping the button, and your score goes from, 7, 8, 9, then player two, who's on a completely different device, will look on their device and see that your score is going from 7, 8, 9. It will be continuously updating over the cloud, using a component called CloudDB. The first thing that we need to do is add another start button. So far, this start button has just affected both players, but now we're going to have a separate start button for each player. So, start button 1, we will change its text property to, instead of say just start, we will specify it to say start player 1. So this will only activate the button for player 1. That's how you choose which one you are. And let's add another button. Drag it in next to it inside the horizontal component. And we'll rename it Start Button 2 and set its text to Start Player 2. Okay, so now we have the two buttons that will correspond to activating the two players. The last new component that we need is the CloudDB component. This is a data structure that will store your current score on the cloud and then pull it to the other devices. This is what enables the multiplayer component. Go ahead and go down to storage and pull up CloudDB. And let's drag it in. You'll see that it shows up in non-visible components because it works in the background, just like the clock does. All right, now we're all set for the components, so let's go to the block section. Click in the upper right-hand corner. Right, so now that we've added a second start button, we need to change our current start button and add the code for the new one. So let's check it out. When start button 1.click. So the only thing here that we need to change is that start button 1 will only enable the player button 1, not player button 2. So we'll just set this 2 to be false. Great, and start button 2 is almost the same as start button 1, except that we will be inverting the true and false here. So let's duplicate this and change this to when start button 2 is clicked. When start button 2, we want to enable the player 2 button. So let's set that to true, but we want to disable the player 1 button. So we'll set that to false. Okay, there we go. That's the start buttons updated. Let's go on to the CloudDB. Let's look through the CloudDB components down here. The first one that we're going to be focusing on is CloudDB.StoreValue. CloudDB.StoreValue is a block that does what it sounds like. It stores a new value to its cloud database. So the values that we're going to want to store are the scores for player 1 and the score for player 2. The tag is the name of the data that you want to store. This can be any name as long as you can remember it well. It's kind of like a variable name. So for the player 1 score, we can just call that player 1 score. Okay, so let's drag out a text block from the text drawer, put it in, and then type in player 1 score. There we go. That's a reasonable descriptive tag for what we're trying to store. Now, what's the value that we want to store? Well, the value that we want to store is the actual number that the player 1 score is. And if you remember, that's stored in the player 1 score label. So if we just grab the text component of it, this will store the score of player 1 in CloudDB. Note that this doesn't give it to player 2 or anything, it's just storing it in the cloud. We'll get it out of the cloud later. Now, where do we put this? we'll be bringing this up here. So when you press the player one button, it's going to update the score and then store it in CloudDB. All right, now let's do the same thing for player two. We can duplicate this. So when the player two button is clicked, what do you want to do? Well, you want to increase the score by one and then save it. So let's call this player two score instead. And the value that we get is from the player two score label instead. There we go. Now, every time that you press the button, it's going to store the updated score in CloudDB. All right, next, we're going to be able to move the data from one device to the other using CloudDB. Let's go back to the CloudDB components. And let's grab when CloudDB.data changed. Okay, so this block will fire every time something has been added or modified to the CloudDB. This happens when we store values, either player one score or player two score. So the two tags that could have been modified are either player one score or player two score. So you can see that it saves the tag and the value that are associated with that specific data changed. The tag is either going to be player one score or player two score, and the value is going to be the numerical value that it is, so, you know, 8 or 10, depending on the number of times that that player has pressed the button. So first, we need to be able to tell what tag it is. Luckily, there's only two options. So we can just use an if statement for that. Let's go to control and pull out an if then. Hover over this and pull in an else if. Drag it into here. And you'll see that this actually modifies it. So if the first thing happens, then do this. Else if a second thing happens instead, then do another thing. This is great. So we'll first check if the tag is player one score, and then if not, we'll check if the tag is player two score. Those are the only two options, so we've covered all of our bases. Let's make that happen. For checking for equality, remember, you can get the equal sign from logic. For whatever the tag is, that's provided right in the block. And the tag that we'll check first is, for example, player one score. So it's going to be this exact text block. I'll write it out here by pulling out a text block from the drawer, dragging it into the equals sign, and then typing in player one.score. Make sure that it's written out exactly the way that we did it here. Otherwise, it won't be able to recognize it. Then we can duplicate it and do the same thing for player two. But instead, of course, it's player two score. Type player two score into the box. All right, these are the two checks. So what if the tag is player one score? That means that we've just modified the player one. So we're going to need to change the score for player one to whatever it is. So remember, the place where we change the score is the player one score label. Let's go ahead and get its text field. And what we want to set it to be is the value that we have from CloudDB, because that's the most updated score. Same thing for player two, except that we'll be modifying the player two score label. If this isn't clear, let's go through an example. Say you're on device one and you are player one, and you've updated your score by one. Then the CloudDB data changed block fires. It's going to check and see that the score is player one score, and it's going to update it. This doesn't matter at all for your device because it's already been updated. Now say that you're in the same scenario, your player two on device two. Even though you haven't been pressing your button, your CloudDB notifies you that the data has been changed and the tag is player one score. So we'll modify your player 1 score.txt to the newest value, even though you're player 2 and you've been pressing the player 2 button. This is great. This is how the transfer of data happens via CloudDB. If you've gotten this far, then congratulations. You've completed the tutorial portion of the 2-button game. This had a lot of new concepts, especially for a CloudDB and checking the tags and values of data. Now, before I go on and show you how to build and test your app and give a final demo, I'd like to explain that there's a lot of different options for you to expand your app if you so wish. For example, you could add a sound that plays every time that the players push a button, maybe a different sound for player 1 than for player 2. You can get this sound from media. There's plenty of players and sound recorders that you can play around with. Another option is having a high score that's saved. You can save this in CloudDB and, for example, use a label to put at the top that shows the high score at all times. Finally, another thing that you could display at the top with the label is a notification of who is currently leading in the game to show who's ahead. That way they don't constantly have to compare. There's tons of other options, and I hope you take the time to implement anything that comes into your mind. Now, to actually test out your app with more than one player, you might notice that just using the regular connect and scanning a QR code doesn't work. This will only allow you to do it with one device. Instead, what you want to do is go to build, and you can provide a QR code which anyone can scan and download the app to their device. You can also save it as a file and send it to your friends. In whichever way that you intend to do it, I hope that you have a lot of fun playing and trying out this game. And without further ado, we can go to the final demo.
Okay, now that we've added the CloudDB component, we have the extra button and we're able to do it with 2 players. Remember to build your app instead of just scanning the QR code. Let's bring in our player 2. And you'll be able to see that with CloudDB, the scores actually update on the screens. So start player 1, start tapping, it updates on the other. Start player 2, start tapping, it updates on the other. And there we go. Now you're free to play with your friends and compete to see who can press the button the fastest and win the 2-button game. This concludes the tutorial for the 2-button game. Thank you so much for going through this with me, and I hope you find many cool uses for CloudDB and the other concepts we've gone through. See you next time.